So if you look at the image behind me, what do you see? At the first glance, it might look like something my kids would have drawn in kindergarten, or more like a graffiti. What if I told you that this is one of the world's deadliest disease? These are cells gone rogue, particularly cells in the brain. Most of the individuals who get highly aggressive or highly malignant brain tumors do not survive more than 15 to 18 months. And unfortunately, in the last two decades, we've not been able to change that. Why? Why haven't we been able to cure cancer efficiently? In some cases we have, but many of the aggressive cancers we have not done well. Most of the cells, of these cancer cells, they find ways to hide from the drugs that are supposed to kill them. And sometimes they also find ways to hide from our own immune system. So I'm here to tell you how we can actually cure cancer with cancer. And this is more like fighting fire with fire, but this concept goes back to the middle of the 18th century when life expectancies began to increase. And one of the major reasons for that was the control of smallpox. And it didn't start with Jenner's, you know, Edward Jenner discovered the smallpox vaccine, so it didn't start with him. It started with actually Lady Montagu. And many of you might not know her name. She was an aristocratic poet, a writer, and one of the very daring ladies in that era. So she took her husband's observation from the Ottoman Empire in Turkey, where he was placed in the military, and brought that into England. And of course, she faced a lot of hurdles when she brought that, because people told her that you're a woman, and you got that from Turkey, and other things. But she was very adamant in making that happen. So people in those days used a procedure called inoculation, where you will give a small dose of smallpox to the patients, and that would cure the smallpox in patients. And if not many of you would have something on the arm like this currently, but if you roll up the sleeves of your parents or grandparents, if they allow you to do that, you will find something similar. And this is a smallpox vaccination mark. Well, it has diminished over time. So we thought, you know, because of this, a number of diseases were cured in the 18th and the 19th century, and that led to the eradication of not only smallpox, but also many diseases like measles and mumps and polio and rinderpest, increasing life expectancy throughout the world. Now, we thought, could we bring this concept of fighting disease with disease to fighting cancer? All we knew at that time when we began was that cancer cells from solid tumors, particularly the breasts and the brain and the lung, love to find their own cells. They actually are shed into the circulation, into the bloodstream, and from there they home to their own tumors. From our own studies in brain, where we've done a lot of study, we knew that cancer cells travel large distances across the brain to find their own types. And if you color code them and put the same tumor cell in two different areas of the brain, two different hemispheres of the brain, you will see they love to come to their own tumor types. They love to follow them, like the bees and the ants. They like to track and follow their counterparts. So how could we use these cancer cells to treat cancer? I mean, could we use their homing ability to treat cancer? So we looked into a number of different things, and when I most importantly, would anyone in my lab, in my team, buy this idea? And when I floated this one, like many of these naive ideas, they thought I had lost it, and that too at a very early age. This is like 5-6 years ago. But my perseverance prevailed somehow, which sometimes does, not at home particularly, but so we began with a simple idea. Could we take patients' own cells and transform them into cancer killers. What we knew, what we had in hand, that we love to play with cells, my lab and my team, we like to bring genes in, we like to take genes out. We somehow like to make them play to our tunes. So we knew that we had the strength. So using our gene engineering and gene editing technology, what we did is we took a patient's own tumor cell and sort of repurposed it to make it as a cancer cell killer. So we also introduced an activatable kill switch because we still had to change that transformed cancer cell. We put an activatable kill switch that would actually self-destruct this cell. So we could actually make a cell that would kill the original tumor cell, and then we would kill the repurposed cell. So ultimately, both cell types would die. So we have absolute control over how we could cure the cancer, because we could also, they could also track these cells in the brain and elsewhere. So we thought this was great, but then, you know, we also know that cancer cells are really clever. They like to hide from our own immune cells. So we thought, why not to bring an immune component into our cells? So we brought an immune modulatory molecule, as you call it, so we can actually not only kill the cells, but also bring immune cells to the site of the tumor so that we don't get any regrowth of the tumors. Now, this was great. We knew that we had something exciting, something unique in our hands. We had a cancer cell that would kill its sister cell, that we could actually repurpose and use it. We also had an activatable kill switch that would kill this repurposed cell. And then we also had a cell that would immune modulate. So it was one cell having three different bullets in the same cell. Now, this is unique, but the key was, how would we translate this into patient settings? And this is where most of these innovations sort of don't go to the next step, because, you know, they stay at the innovation step. So I'm a big believer of integrating different disciplines, and this I've done at different levels, but at a scientific level, I'd like to bring the structure to the innovation and also combine different disciplines together. And one of the things in our settings that we looked at, could we combine gene manipulation? That's what my lab and my team members do very often. Could we bring material science into this? And we've heard this since morning that, you know, bringing different disciplines together. And could we bring tumor biology and tumor models, that mouse tumor models that we've used to mimic the disease? One of the major problems in science is, can we mimic a disease that we see in an individual and bring it to a mouse? Because that's where most of the preclinical work happens. So we have expertise in building models that mimic diseases in mouse. So this would ultimately lead to the therapy, particularly in highly aggressive brain tumors where people have only 15 to 18 months to live. Now, what we did is, if we take a case of a brain tumor patient, and this might sound very surprising, because many of these patients, 85% of these highly aggressive brain tumor patients, their tumor is resected after 5 days of diagnosis. Then the drugs don't reach, the drugs that are given orally or injected, they don't reach the brain because there's a barrier between the blood and the brain. And then this cavity gets filled with the cerebrospinal fluid, or the fluid of the brain and the blood. So we thought, why don't we combine material science and our cells and encapsulate those cells and place them in the cavity that is created after resection or removal of the tumor? And we now, when we place the cells in this cavity, these cells kill the original cells, and then we can kill these green cells, what you see, with an activatable kill switch. So actually, we can kill everything, and then we can bring immune cells to the place of the tumor, so you get protected from the rest. So from the tumor, getting tumor again. So we've done this in a lot of models, particularly primary brain tumor models. Again, this is very experimental in primary brain tumor models, recurrent brain tumor models, and also in a number of metastatic diseases. You know, you get metastases when when you cure a breast tumor and that it ultimately ends up in the brain. So we've shown that we can actually cure. In particular, we've shown that if you cure lung tumor, after a while, our mice get immunized and they don't get tumors in the brain anymore. So this works very well, and we're hoping that we are in the clinics within the next 4 or 5 years. Of course, it's again a different domain from going into preclinical studies into clinical studies. So this is all exciting for us. So 3 years ago, I lost my dad to highly aggressive brain tumors. And he lasted only 8 weeks after he was diagnosed. And this is one of the shortest times between diagnosis and his passing away. And I've been at the forefront of trying to find a cure for cancer with my team. And I didn't know that it would hit home one day the way it hit. It was very ironic because I'm very connected to curing cancer and very connected to curing brain tumor particularly. And so during my time that I spent with him in those 8 weeks, I think I spent 7 of the 8 weeks with him, and I realized that when an individual knows that you have only 6 to 7 weeks or 2 months to live, I mean, it's devastating for an individual and for, in particular for the loved ones as well. We all felt helpless. Well, now, this has given me something further to address, further strengthen my motivation, not only to work harder on this, but also to think outside the box. And find and integrate different disciplines. I think we have to integrate different disciplines to find a cure. It can't be a magic bullet. And also, the other thing that I firmly believe in is that the integration of the old medicine and the new medicine, we really cannot ignore what we know from the old medicine, from the Chinese, the ancient, the Persian medicine, particularly about microbiome now, and combining those disciplines and ultimately finding a cure for cancer. Thank you.